Today's topic for the debate is not new to us. You must be knowing that COVID-19 pandemic has affected everyone around the country. In this type of situation, the government's job is to stop the virus from spreading and make sure everyone is safe and keeping the economy running. Hence, today's concern in the debate is, has the Indian government handled the corona crisis efficiently? But before starting with the debate, let us brief everyone with the rules and regulations.
So, everyone is expected to keep their mics turned off and cameras on whenever not needed, but the cameras need to be on in the whole event. Speakers for the motion will be 7, speakers against the motion will be 7. Each speaker will get 3.5 minutes for his speech. There are 3 interjectors in total, Anushka Sharma, Parthi Mittal, and Vinayak Sharma.
Each speaker will get 3.5 minutes to speak, and after 3 minutes, there will be a warning bell. The speaker need to round up his speech within 30 seconds. Second warning bell will be the final bell. The speaker will have to wrap up as soon as the second bell is rang. The interjectors will ask one question each to the speaker, and the speaker will get 1 minute to answer the question.
Well, now, starting on with the debate, I would like to call our first participant, Krishna Lala, to put a headstrong opinion in favor of the motion. Go ahead, Krishna.
Good morning, respected principal, sir, teachers, and my dear friends. As we all know that the whole world has been contrived by the corona pandemic, India being one of the worst hit countries, I, as the first speaker for the motion, would like to start by conversing about some technological plans. The government recently introduced the Arogya Setu mobile application to educate citizens about COVID-19 and help them make informed decisions during the pandemic. Union HRD Minister Ramesh Pokhriyal launched a web portal on 23rd June to monitor and record the initiative by the ministry to combat COVID-19 with knowledge, technology, and innovation. Next, I would like to elaborate some points regarding the retails and fuel for cooking, which is, according to me, one of the most important things needed by the masses to survive and sustain. The government plans to set up a chain of 20 lakh retail shops called as Suraksha stores across India, which will provide daily essentials to citizens while following stringent safety norms. Also, under its Ujjwala scheme, the government is granting free LPG refills to over 8.3 crore poor women. Coming next are the few points regarding the financial and banking sector. Under the National Social Assistance Program, Rs 1,400 crore has been disbursed to more than 2.8 crore old age people, widows and disabled people. The last date for filling income tax returns for the financial year 2019-20 has been extended to November 30th. The interest rate on delayed income tax payment has been dwindled from 12% to 9%. Grant of medical insurance covered worth Rs 50 lakh per medical personnel, including doctors, paramedics, medical staff, and etc. Moreover, I would like to throw some light on a couple of direct benefits and relief for the power generating sectors. MG Narega workers have got a wage increase of Rs 20, which will benefit 50 million families. The wage increase amount into an additional income of 22,000 rupees per worker, an enormous amount of rupees, 90,000 crore, or I would say 11.7 billion US dollars liquidity infusion to DISCOMs against the receivables guaranteed by the state government for the purpose of discharging liabilities to power generating firms. Lastly, I would like to say that the government made a commendable, assertive, and a responsible effort by imposing national lockdown, which helped prevent the spread of the pandemic at community level. And it won't be a great way of questioning the government according to which its steps has been taken. So I would like to recommend everybody to support the motion. Thank you.
Well, what an excellent start, Krishna, I must say. But the participants must have complete knowledge about their topic. And for the same, we have a well-researched team of our interjectors who will question your wisdom on the agenda. So now I request for Anushka Sharma to come up and ask you questions.
My friend, students are left with no other option other than online learning in this corona crisis. But virtual classrooms can never be an alternative for actual classrooms. Yes, I understand it's a good initiative, but how can the students of rural India without e-resources engage in online learning? And also, these online learning initiatives are affecting on a lot of health of the students. So what are your views about it?
Your question was nice. So first I would like to answer by starting stating the point that people in the rural areas are, I know they are unfortunate, they don't have smartphones available to them. So if they are not having that type of technology, they can't avail the online classes. They have to get the books from their known ones, or they have to arrange it from somewhere to study. And regarding the problem you stated about the health of the children, so they need proper orientation classes, the children and their parents also, which will help the children to know the method of the correct method of attending online classes and not spending a lot of hours online. So I think that would be the answer for your question. That would be my view. Thank you.
Great answer, Krishna. And thank you, Anushka. But do not forget, a coin has two faces. So we should now invite Manya Bakriwal to highlight her views against the motion.
The mother is angry. She has just begun to vent her fury as she conserves with the sun. She gives her warnings as the elements explode, showing how vulnerable humans are in their humble abode. Namaskar. Amidst dealing with the mass agitation protesting against the anti-Muslim citizenship law, an unpredictable wrench, namely the COVID-19, has brought the country to a halt like nothing else could. My friends, the tragedy is immediate, real, epic, and yes, it's unfolding before our eyes. But it was only after Modi announced nationwide lockdown on the evening of March 24th that it began to dawn Indians that there was no plans. It was only after, on March 19th, Modi announced that he had already created a special task force to mitigate the economic distress that coronavirus would invariably provoke. But while he had done no such thing like that, it was only after on the hands of the finance minister.
Tremendous performance, Manya. But before we proceed, we would like to acknowledge the presence of Captain B.C. Kumawat, sir, the director of BVB Bhavan Jaipur Kendra. Welcome, sir.
Carry on, Jay, carry on. He has given the thumbs up, so you carry on now.
As Manya is not... Okay. Continue, Manya.
Yeah. This should I start again or what? Should I continue?
Judges will have to intervene into this in case they wish that they want to give another chance to the child.
I guess there was some connectivity issue, I believe, because the call just got disconnected.
So I think she can be given another chance.
Go ahead.
So should I start again?
Yes. Yes.
Thank you. The mother is angry. She had just begun to vent her fury as she conserves with the sun. She gives her warnings as the elements explore, showing how wonderful humans are in their humble abode. Namaskar. Amidst dealing with the mass agitation protesting against the brazenly discriminatory anti-Muslim citizenship law, an unpredictable wretch, namely the COVID-19, has brought the country to a halt like nothing else could. The tragedy is immediate, real, epic, and unfolding before our eyes. It was only after Modi announced a nationwide lockdown on the evening of March 24th that it began to dawn Indians that there was no plan. Modi told Indians on March 19 that he had already created a special task force to mitigate the economic distress that coronavirus would invariably provoke. Well, he had done no such thing. Among those who haven't heard of corona, who haven't heard of the special task force existence, who according to Modi, the finance minister, would be chairing it. Thus, Modi is told that he was taking a decision as a family member, not as a prime minister. But who else could rather than Modi decide without consulting the state governments would have to deal with a mass population of 1.82 billion with zero fallout preparation with just 4 hours notice? The sudden shutting down of production and distribution has led to the collapse of economy and running millions jobless. Sadly, Modi's two national addresses have done a little to concern about India not taking the mass testing approach. Well, the question may arise, how many people have got tested? How many doctors have protective care? Or how many ventilators the government managed to buy overnight? I just believe this lockdown is just turning into another demonetization as the medical supplies were cleverly disrupted as we are still fighting a pandemic. It is estimated that the critical beds constitute only 5% of the total hospital beds, and only 5% of ICU beds are provided for corona patients. In a few weeks, we find ourselves in defiance of numbers, while the economy might start looking like the 1980s. The plan of Unlock 1.0 gives economic focus while the GDP has dropped to 4.2. The plan for Unlock is equally bizarre. As the appalled world watched India reveal itself in brutal shape, you call it structurally, mentally, or socially. I was in terrible despair when millions were driven out there in the barren road, waiting for some transportation facilities, or they were carrying hunger, disease, with nowhere else to go. Well, the very Prime Minister of India probably be working on the next grandiose to the nation, while doing it for his territory. Thus, I conclude that our minds are still running back and forth, longing for the return to normality, trying to stitch our future with the past, refusing to acknowledge the rupture. But my dear friends, the rupture exists. Yes, the rupture exists, which gives us a chance to rethink the doomsday machine we have built for ourselves. Thus, I would like to conclude that we need to accept the new normal and flow with it. Thank you.
Tremendous performance, Manya. But let me call Paki to get you some trouble.
Yes, so it is stated that 97% Indians say that lockdown is the right step to combat the pandemic. And you said, and as you said, that this, the health workers and all, they are affected by it. Then why are the people saying that lockdown of public and lockout of economy is not the way to get through this pandemic?
Thank you for your question, Paki. I would really appreciate it. Well, 97% of the people think about it. But what about the 3% others? We haven't included the migrant workers. What about them? Were the transportation facilities provided by the government? Or I guess they were just left barren on the road without not even helping them out with their situations, not having any contacts. And how could we just tell how many people are literally getting tested? Or it's just a game of monopoly we are asking for? Like about testing people and people getting tested positive or negative? Or it's just to boost the economy? Well, as the private hospitals do so. Thank you.
Very well answered, Manya, I must say. But
Let me mention it to the audience that if anyone feels like boosting up the participants, encouraging them, here the comment box is for you. Go ahead. Now, moving forward, I would like to call Hemashrita Manna to outstand everyone in favor of the motion. Here you go, Hemashrita.
Good morning to Manila present here. In the USA, a superpower of the world, there are 22 lakh confirmed cases with around 1.2 lakh deaths. Whereas in India, a country with a much larger population, there are 4.2 lakh confirmed cases and only 14,000 deaths. This data shows that the measures taken by the Indian government have proved to be effective. The most drastic measure taken by the Indian government was a nationwide lockdown, which was started on 25th March 2020 under the National Disaster Management Act. According to the statistics, there would have been 8 lakh cases by mid-April itself if it weren't for the lockdown. The government then introduced a 20 lakh crore package, which was comprised of 5 tranches. The first tranche provided credit line to small businesses and support to shadow banks and electricity distribution companies. The second tranche included free food grain to stranded migrant workers for 2 months and credit to farmers. The third tranche focused on agricultural infrastructure and other measures for agriculture. The fourth and fifth tranches dealt with the structural reforms. To treat the coronavirus patients, the central government has prepared dedicated hospitals. These hospitals have 1.8 lakh beds, with around 30,000 of them reserved for the acute cases. These dedicated hospitals also have ventilators for acute cases. The country also has 7,000 COVID-19 care centers, which have around 6.5 lakh beds. Amidst the lockdown, a lot of people became unemployed. The Union government is planning to give unemployment benefits to the section of these workers. The government's Atal Bima Vyakti Kalyan Yojana, which provides unemployment insurance to workers who have subscribed to the Employee State Insurance Scheme, will cover such workers during the pandemic. Also, under the Pradhan Mantri Gramin Kalyan Yojana, in the view of the pandemic, the center credited rupees 500 each to over 4.07 crore women Jandhan account holders. Similarly, the government has announced relief for daily wage worker and construction worker for an amount of rupees 1,000 per person for all states and union territories. Also, under the Pradhan Mantri Kalyan Samman Nidhi, an income support of rupees 6,000 per year is provided to all farmer families across country in 3 equal installments of rupees 2,000 each every 4 months. At last, I would like to say that because of these measures, the fatality rate of coronavirus has dropped down from 3.29% to 2.83%, and that the government is doing the best with taking the public's interest in mind. Thank you.
Great attempt, Hemashree. But now here I invite our interjector Vinayak Sharma to get you some panic through his questions.
Many countries that have done a relatively good job against coronavirus have refrained from putting a complete lockdown in the nation. Whereas in India, at 8 p.m., the PM addressed the nation and said that at the midnight, the nation would be under complete lockdown. So don't you think that there would have been some spare time given to complete the delayed works, and the international flights should have been banned at the start completely? And you also talked about that for the doctors and the medical workers, there were many methods that were ensured by the government, but still, the... Hello. But still, 4,500 rupees were to be given for COVID-19 test that was free in other countries. So what are your views about it?
Well, you first mentioned that the flight should be banned, but the government did suspend all flights till April 15th. And that was good. And as you mentioned that some countries didn't have a lockdown, you have to also take in account the population of India, which is much larger than of other countries. Like the European countries, they have a very small population. It doesn't work. It will not work here. And you also mentioned about the healthcare workers. They are surely given some protection by the government, and thank you.
Thank you, Vinayak, for that interesting question. Now, I invite Katyani Yadav to express her thoughts against the motion.
Namaskar everyone, I'm Katyani and today I will present my views in against of the motion. I have a strong opinion that Sri Prime Minister Narendra Modi's poorly planned lockdown won't save us from the virus, but will surely kill the economy of India. Prime Minister's national lockdown has starved Indians to death and won't save us from the virus. Prime Minister put 1.3 billion people under a curfew-like lockdown. Thus, this time can be seen as a buying time to create a massive infrastructure so that even asymptomatic people can be tested and quarantined. The lack of widespread testing and the lack of PPE kits for doctors is a scandal. South Korea, which had the largest outbreak outside China, used contact tracing, stern public health, a strict quarantine regime so that the coronavirus cannot spread. If the lockdown had any effect, you would see the slope to be flattened or bent towards the horizontal axis. There is no question that the testing in India remains slow on the gradual standards. India has so far conducted 5 lakh tests as compared to 1 lakh tests per day in US. Given the significant economic and human costs suffered due to it, thus lockdown can be considered as a complete failure. Delhi and Mumbai both have better healthcare facilities or better higher density of healthcare professionals. Despite this clear edge, why both the metro cities have failed to contain the spread of the virus, which has led to the loss of so many precious lives? If we compare the scenario of Delhi and Mumbai with Uttar Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh has a population of nearly 22 crore, and the government rigorously implemented the guidelines and advisories from time to time and adhered to regular and strict enforcement of the laws. This strategy succeeded in containing the spread of the virus and the number of deaths, though the state received so many migrant workers from various coronavirus hotspots. On the other hand, Delhi, with so many resources at its command, was not able to handle the spread of the virus. Mostly, 90% of the population in India work in unorganized or informal sector of the economy. The pandemic has caused great uncertainty to their future as they were thrown out of work. Many laborers were attempt to leave the large urban centers to go to the villages and were compelled to take perilous journeys on their foot and have died throughout the lockdown. However, if we think that the lockdown had such an effect, India has lost a great opportunity for increasing its healthcare and public health capacity. Thank you.
What a headstrong opinion, Katyani, I must say. What a headstrong opinion. And now I would like to call our interjector, Anushka Sharma, to get Katyani a shake.
Yes, definitely. Although I believe I agree that lockdown has posed a lot of problems, but
Sorry, can you repeat the question? I'm not getting your voice clearly.
There are 348 infections per million. Can we Anushka,
just repeat your question. She's not able to hear.
Okay. Although I agree that lockdown has posed a lot of problems for all of us, but social distancing is the only remedy to break the chain of the virus. Thus, lockdown has served a vast purpose. And as you mentioned, that the PPE kits, the medical resources which are provided to the medical staff are less. But let me tell you, 3 lakh PPE kits and N95 masks are generated every day, which is the highest in the world. So, is this not effective management?
I don't think so, because every doctor needs some protective gear so that he can protect himself from spreading the coronavirus. But if the lockdown had any effect, or any doctor who had sufficient number of PPE kits, then why the number of cases have increased despite having 4 or 5 lockdowns continuously? If the doctor... Sorry,
you misunderstood my question. I told you that lockdown, social distancing is the only remedy. So lockdown was important, and you were criticizing about lockdown in your whole thing.
Lockdown was important, but the people also want to, the people also need to understand that the lockdown is the only way. If the lockdown was not applied, the number of cases would have increased. But if the lockdown has applied, then also the number of cases have been increased. I know that social distancing is the only way. This is all I want to say.
Mortality rate is still low in India.
I don't think counter questioning is permitted. If I know the rules correctly, judges can, or maybe the organizers can, look into this aspect. Cross questioning will lead to so many complications. I think somewhere we need to restrict it.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so now heading forward, I call upon Ritika Nogia to express her outlook in favor of the motion. Audience, please keep your enthusiasm high.
There will be little rubs and disappointments everywhere, and we are all apt to expect too much. But then, if one scheme of happiness fails, human nature turns to another. If the first calculation is wrong, we make a second better. We find comfort somewhere, right? But still, there are some people who are stick to this hypothesis that government's intentions are good, but flawed execution. They believe that soon Modi-led government will lose support. But unfortunately, I have a bad news for all those stereotypical heads that 93.5% of people in India believe that the Prime Minister Narendra Modi-led government is handling the coronavirus pandemic in an effective manner, according to a survey conducted by Indo-Asian News Service Voter. The number of people who laid trust on Modi government on the first day of lockdown was 76.8%, and that has increased now. The Indian government is facing an extraordinary challenge to protect over a billion densely packed people, which is beyond our imagination. But still, ramped up efforts are taking place. Like recently, our government introduced the Arogya Setu application to educate citizens about the COVID-19 crisis. And they have also said that migrant workers returning would be given employment under MNREGA. And how can we forget about the chain of lockdowns introduced by our government, which not only control the number of corona positives, but also clear air pollution so that Himalayan peaks are visible from Jalandhar, Punjab, which is situated 140 kilometers away. And this tells us that how much air pollution make difference in the beauty of a city. But most of the people in our country are not concerned with such issues. But if a Mandir Masjid issue is raised, then a lot of 100 people will gather and rise up to protest and support. This here I realized that since my childhood I was being fooled that I was being told that in India people support each other and live with so much of love. But now I know the score. People here are more interested in questioning their own government at the point of time when the government needs them the most. Nevertheless, our government is still trying to amid the crisis. Our finance minister, Nirmala Sitharaman, herself said that we don't want anyone to remain hungry. We will take care of the protein requirement of poor and give money in their hand through direct benefit transfer. She also introduced 1.7 lakh crore rupee package, in which she introduced a relief package which was diversity is the art of thinking together independently. And how beautiful it would be that 1.3 billion people are putting their heads together to fight against this pandemic. So all you have to do is you have to listen to that 30-second caller tune carefully, because it always tells you that you don't have to you have to stay home and you don't have to step out of your place, considering it as your family. So with this support soon, Corona, with the story of past and the Indian economy, will jump and accelerate the various modes of revenue generation as quickly as possible. Thank you.
Very well done, Ritika. Now, I invite Paki Mittal to fire up some questions on Ritika.
Yes, I agree that all your points that government has taken many steps to make the public safe and for its protection. But then also, what about our rural India? Like, what is the central government doing to ensure all Indians have equal access to testing, no matter which state they live in and whatever they can afford to pay for the test?
I absolutely agree with you. Actually, due to the short span of time, I missed that point, a newly framed policies introduced under a Prime Minister Garib Kalyan Yojana, in which the government aims to alleviate the financial pain faced by the rural and urban poor as well, and the migrant workers, farmers, and for the women as well.
That was an excellent answer, Ritika. Now, I would like to invite Hiyashi Jain to put forward her thoughts against the motion.
The coronavirus outbreak has created havoc in the whole world. In mere 7 months, the virus has its grip over almost every part of the world. Countries having best medical and healthcare facilities have failed in blending their curve. Rather, the situation is getting worse day by day, and the infection is spreading like a wildfire. In a country like India, which has a long and unfortunate history of class and caste basis, which is now even more prominent under a national crisis. With all non-essential businesses and workplaces shut, millions of laborers are staring at the very real prospect of hunger, eviction from their home, and indefinite unknown for what the future holds. The government implemented lockdown and all the other policies after 500 plus cases were recorded in the country, and that too in a very short notice. The government focused on some necessities like groceries and supplies, but then many factors were neglected, like how the migrant workers will find homes without wages. The BBC reported told of migrant workers surviving off water and biscuit as they headed home, carrying their children over their shoulders while the blaring heat of April and May. The country was kept in a complete lockdown for months to contain the spread of coronavirus. But now it seems like nothing is going to work because the situation of the country is very severe and everything is moving out of the hands of the authorities. India has surpassed Italy and Spain.
Tremendous performance, Yashi. Now let's call Vinayak to test your knowledge.
India is a very populous country and there might be problems with some sections of society. However, 91% people believe that lockdown is a success. So we can't just deny the fact that the government of India had ensured that the people stay safe and many policies have been taken on for their safety. I would say that lockdown had a very positive impact on nature and the environment. Even the pollution levels went down and the India's recovery rate too increased and people got time to inside their homes to enjoy with their family. So what do you would like to say about it?
Okay, definitely people got time to enjoy with their families, but then there are many people in the country who cannot prioritize their health issues in front of the economic issues. If you know the population of India and the poor population, they cannot prioritize one. They have to keep both the things hand to hand. And the government implemented lockdown, that was commendable, but then they should have planned it before in a very nice manner. Like many migrant workers were facing a lot of issues and problems, and that was causing a lot of crisis in the country. Thank you.
Very well answered, Yachi, I must be saying that. Well, don't forget, a true sportsman never fears his objector. So here I now call upon Garv Haldia to share his views in favor of the motion. Here you go, Garv.
Jaan hai to jahan hai. India's belief in every policy of COVID-19. India's response to this COVID-19 battlefield has been vigorously progressive and very progressive among the countries. On March 19, where the COVID-19 cases were 150 in India, the government banned the export of all kinds of surgical masks and ventilators. The hospital beds in India per 1,000 persons in a meter is 0.7, several notches below US, Canada, China, and etc. So bear in mind that India entered this COVID-19 battlefield with its bare hands, a fragile and underfunded public healthcare system, and a very low economy. So it has its only potent weapon, a 21-day lockdown. And to those people who think that this lockdown has created a huge economic surplus in the country, this is a fundamental problem of misframing the question. If you see from a life of a daily wage laborer, health and income are equally proximate issues, and you can't prioritize over that. If we take an example of US, the superpower which has more economy, literacy rate, and also 1/3 population from India, still feared from implementing a proper lockdown, whereas the Indian government has never hesitated from protecting the lives of 1.3 billion people apart from its economy. And in the lockdown also, India ensured its proper and adequate health infrastructure and also mass production of N95 masks, PPE kits, and also drugs like hydroxychloroquine. And today, India is in such a state that if it is required, India is ready to export too. So rather than being any liability, India is being an asset to this global pandemic. And this is also shown as in the mortality rate of India is among the least in the world, which is 3.2%, and even lesser in several states, whereas the global fatality rate is around 7 to 7.5%. This is a double-edged sword, a strong PMO and a central decision-making system has led to tough and bold decisions. These decisions may be less deliberated upon time and thought, but India is improvising on each and every step and is learning from their mistakes. As a result, India now ramps up into COVID-19 hospitals, convert railway coaches into mobile treatment plants. And also, government is aware of its shortcomings and are trying to achieve those as soon as possible. And also ensuring cohesion, like maybe it be the 5 p.m. clapping or 9 p.m. lighting the candle. The Modi ji believes that sharing a crisis creates a family, and the 5 p.m. clapping may appear silly, but it is a huge social proof of life thriving over fear and death. And to those people who think that India is lacking behind in the implementation of their policies, India has been praised all over the world because of its policies and its implementation. At last, I would just like to say that just like the polio epidemic of 2004, India will surely win and will surely get over this one. Thank you.
Very well done, girls. And now I'd like to call Anushka to fire some bewildering questions on GURF.
My friend, do you think that the testing procedures, sample collected, and PPE kit, etc., were appropriate in number at a good pace in the starting phase? Was that not a failure of the government that they could not manage to combat the disease in its starting phase? If we see the statistics, only 32 tests per million till date are be done, which are the least, one among the least in the world. And if we talk about the mass sanitation, only symbolic incidents can be quoted. So is this not a failure for the government? Do you think this is the effective handling of a crisis?
See, in the starting, India is not a very good India has not developed a very good technology. I agree that. But we see that India's population is the second largest population, 1.3 billion people. If India is taking a little more time in affecting and in testing or in getting to localize people and in rural areas, it is all right, because India has so much pressure from just like in this case scenario, India's political boundaries and be compromised. And also this COVID-19 battle is been tough for India. So India is going at its own pace and is implementing the problems very correctly.
That was a terrific performance from GURF. Now, I would like to call upon Janvi Agarwal to present everyone with her views against the motion.
The coronavirus is shining an uncomfortable light on the lack of preparedness of the strategies around the world. The whole world is under a spread of coronavirus, and India is not spared of it. But before I come to my own arguments, I found some correction in what my dear friend Ritika just stated. From her argument, it seems there is no problem in the way government is dealing with the virus. But then why the number of cases increases so rapidly? There are almost 15,000 cases every day, and India lag behind the countries like UK in number of cases. So let me throw the light on government policies which look good in theory, but when implemented, they are not very successful. So the first step government took was a lockdown. It was a good solution, but turns in conundrum. India is the second most populated country and fifth biggest economy. Yet, despite its size, India, Prime Minister Narendra Modi has put 1.3 billion under a curfew-like lockdown. A national curfew for 21 days will definitely go along in reducing the transmission of a deadly virus. But what happened after 21 days? The virus won't disappear after that. In other words, we are in the mess of 4 years. India entered the battlefield with an economy that had been slowing down for multiple quarters. India's existing safety net and income support programs do not adequately target households in the quintiles that have experienced several dramatic job losses due to the lockdown. Rural households have experienced 88% of urban 88% of them reporting a fall in income compared to 75% of rural households. At this rate, more Indians might die of hunger than of coronavirus. In a few weeks, the economy might start looking like the 1980s. Coming to the foremost wrangle that needs to be conferred about is the healthcare. Without secure supply chains, the risk to healthcare workers around the world is real. Industry and governments must act quickly to boost supply, ease export restrictions, and put measures to place to stop speculation and hoarding. We can't stop COVID-19 without protecting healthcare workers first, said WHO Director General Dr. Tedros Adhanom Ghebreyesus. Since these workers are on contract, government is not accountable for their vulnerabilities and risk of exposure to COVID-19. What this epidemic has highlighted, the callous attitude of the government. The lockdown has already disproportionately hurt marginalized communities due to loss of food, loss of livelihood, and other basic needs. government does the responsibility to protect the well-being of the population. But some of these steps have left thousands of workers left behind. So far, government have not properly arranged his policies and so the need to R is to join hands properly and to find a cure. So at last, I want to conclude by saying, started in China, now the world is sick. Let's unite and get a and find a cure quick. Thank you.
Excellent thought, Janvi. Paki, we are now waiting for your fiery questions to come up.
Yes. So, Janvi, I agree with all your points. But since like our government has appointed police officers, health workers, and every step that the government should take and to protect us public, I think that to ensure that the public is safe, the workers are working day and night, right? And PM Modi is not only established as an Indian leader, but as a world leader also. So why is the leaders and the public showing such a negative attitude towards the government?
It's not the attitude the Indians are showing towards the government. It's just the policies which are left behind. As Ritika, my dear friend, has just stated, it's like 93.5 believe that Prime Minister is a great leader. But what about 6.5% people? They are not agreeing with the policies. And in his speech, Prime Minister didn't recognize about migrant workers. What about that? Okay, I agree that he is recognized as a world leader. But then I don't think so that I just thinking about the 6.5% of people. I agree. 93% of people are agreeing. But what about 6.5? We are not doing that majority and minority ones. People also exist. It's a democratic country and we are able to think about 6.5%. Thank you.
Well, the participants are doing their job tremendously well and excellent. And now I call upon our brave participant, Kanishka Cholak, with her opinion in favor of the motion. Here to you, Kanishka.
Namaskar. Missing the kiosks of supermarkets, walking in the busy streets, and having fun with friends. That's what we all are dreaming of. And the reason is just one, COVID-19. Also termed as coronavirus disease 2019, this virus has been proved to be a deadly disaster for the mankind and has ruined the economy of any nation. Every country, developing or developed, is battling against this pandemic. But I believe that India is doing better than any other country. Despite of a huge population, our country has shown good recovery rate and slower spreading rate. And this has been achieved due to the efforts our government has put in. But many of my opponents are arguing that government has not made successful attempts in controlling the coronavirus. To start off, I would like to take Arogya Setu app. I'm sorry, but turned off by survey, sir. Yeah. Am I audible?
Please carry on. Yeah, please carry on.
To start off, I would like to take note of Arogya Setu app and the set of guidelines introduced by Ayush Mantralaya to direct people about the practices they should carry out during the crisis. Not only this, our country entered the battlefield of COVID-19 with the most potent weapon, a 21-day complete lockdown when the virus was on its initial stage. Any delay in lockdown could have resulted in a spike in cases. And if we talk about the migrants who suffered during the lockdown, it would not be wrong to say that government was the one who helped them. They provided them public vehicles and food so that they can reach their hometown safely. The work of spreading awareness was also done very well by the government. They ensured that public don't panic in this state of motion, and so they decided to telecast Ramayan once again. It is not that government safeguarded the public during lockdown only. After unlock also, they had distributed every place zone-wise, so there is less risk of transmission. They introduced financial packages for COVID-19 hit sectors. They opened public places, but with strict implications of social distancing and mask wearing. Another evidence I want to impart is of educational sector. Government has not yet come with the decision of commencement of schools, and important exams are also postponed because government is concerned of students' health. Instead, they have launched online classes and book apps so that students can continue preparing safely. Lastly, I would like to add something about the medical sector. Our Prime Minister himself stated that our country is not dependent on any nation for the imports of PPE kits and masks. We have stolen him of doctors, healthcare workers, and civic workers who are helping us selflessly. And this has been conquered just because of the vigilant plan and consciousness of our government. Don't you think it is our government who is working efficiently to keep us safe? I believe that because of government's effort, India is dealing with the situation magnificently. We need to appreciate and endorse our government. We should keep trying because hope and courage make victory possible. Thank you. Stay home, stay safe.
You're very well said. What a headstrong opinion, Kanishka, I must say. And I hope the whole audience is here enjoying and making most of it. And now, moving forward, let me call our interjector. Over to the interjectors.
2 points I would like to highlight that you all are saying that the PPE kits, ventilators, and the beds are being ordered or manufactured, but are they available to all common people? Simply no. The migrant people, they were too are being provided with facilities like vehicles, but now as the cases have been increased, now don't you think that the cases would increase further as the coronavirus has come to community transmission from local transmission? So instead of the vehicles provided being now, shouldn't have they been provided at the start before the lockdown? With the spare time given, and you're talking about Arogya Setu app, this doesn't show that who are the people who are getting affected, or it only shows the number of people that are getting affected nearby you, initiating a state of fear in the minds of people. The supply chains of very important articles like masks and medical facilities were broken, and the farmers that are growing the rabi crops were also hampered. The online classes are effective, but we doesn't feel like we are sitting in the normal classes. And so, don't you think that the plan was there, but not effective planning?
I believe that government is doing every possible act they can do for the COVID-19. First of all, I would like to take the note of online classes, as you said. In this time of crisis, we cannot go to the schools and study. So they have launched online classes because so that we don't lag anywhere. Our studies don't lag. When coronavirus will speed down, then we'll definitely join the schools. But for our safety, only online classes are launched. Then I would like to take Arogya Setu app. As you said, it shows about the patients who are near us. So it is for our safety. We'll know that all are the people near us. And so we can prevent ourselves, we can apply the rule of social distancing and everything. Then you said about the migrants who suffered. So I would say that India is a democratic country. So anything, any rule which needs to be applied takes some time. So government was working upon the labor class and all the people. And so it took time for them to arrange all the vehicles and everything for them. And thank you.
Well answered, Kanishka. I now invite Disha Chawla to present her views against the agenda.
Namaskar, I'm Disha Chawla of class 10th E and I'm going to speak against the motion. So as we all are aware that Prime Minister Narendra Modi has put 1.3 billion people under a curfew like lockdown. After the first lockdown, it kept extending and helped in reducing the transmission of the deadly virus. But what happens? After this also, the virus won't disappear. Not until we get a vaccine, and it will take at least a few months to vaccinate every Indian, even after a vaccine has been developed. The lack of widespread testing, as well as the lack of personal protective equipment for doctors, is a scandal. Even if we survive the pandemic, we won't survive the impending economic collapse. Demonetization and GST resulted in killing demand. And now, this poorly planned national curfew will kill the supply chains. We'll be left with a great Indian discovery, the zero. Modi announced a national curfew with a little notice. He addressed the nation at 8 p.m. and the curfew came into force at midnight, just like demonetization. Why couldn't he have given some notice? Why couldn't he have addressed the nation at 8 a.m. in the morning? Narendra Modi exhorted his countrymen to light candles and lamps in a gesture of united fight against COVID-19. Why is the Prime Minister focusing on seemingly pointless rituals while he needs to be telling the nation the details of how we are fighting the pandemic? On 30th January, the first case was confirmed in Kerala's Thrissur district in a student who had returned home from Wuhan University in China. When the first case was reported, the central government did not pay much attention to it. India did not take it seriously. The cases kept increasing and yet no serious step was taken till mid-March. What was the government doing from last 2 months? As we say, no use of crying over split milk. The government should have stopped all the foreign activities just when the first case was noted. But at that time, the government was busy with its politics. If the government implemented the policies in a better way, then probably there would not be as much cases as there are now. And now that the cases are increasing, if the lockdown is to be removed, because suddenly the government is worrying about the economy, then it should be removed partially. There are men, women and children who are walking as far as Eastern UP and Bihar. The planes were sent to bring the citizens from Europe. Why wasn't the transport being organized for the most poorest and the vulnerable amongst us home? Isn't it government's moral duty to help the fellow citizens during this time of crisis? I believe that everything has its own pros and cons, and the cons could be improved if the governments work harder. Thank you.
Excellent performance, Disha. Now, I would like to request Anushka to baffle Disha with her questions.
Disha, I would like to know that you are, I would like to ask you that when the first outbreak came, started in China and then in Kerala, Indian government was vigilant and it started with the first lockdown. So everybody was in lockdown, that social distancing was managed. So everything was in control till then. And that is why we now have a low mortality rate, a fast recovery rate, and a less number of infection. Next, I would like to ask you, all of us know that to overcome a disease, mutual, emotional, social bonding with positivity is strengthen the nation is required. Is it inappropriate to welcome and pay gratitude and boast the morale of our corona warriors who are sacrificing their lives for us? Is this not an effective handling of a crisis?
I don't believe this is an effective handling of a crisis because, as you said, that the mortality rate is low and the cases. As you said, na, so I believe that the testing in India is still, the rate of testing in India is still low. And in Beijing, from 12th June to 17th June, the number of people tested were around 17 lakhs, I guess. And in India, in overall India, the testing was low than the testing was done in Beijing.
Very well done. Now, I invite Saloni Vijay to present her outlook in favor of the motion. Go ahead, Saloni.
Namaskar. Our fingers are all crossed as we all hope for a cure. Friends have journeyed to the land of the dead. Enemies have journeyed as well. We are now united by sympathies, but still divided by entities. Her compassion cannot travel beyond the walls of our rooms. We are now left with only the guidelines of our government. Only the guidelines of our government. Yes, In this pandemic situation, Indian government is the only one who could help us out. From the very beginning only, it had been cautious enough to deal with the situation. Yes, India did better than many, or I must say most of the countries. It responded quickly, often ahead of many countries, and its responses were dynamic with evolving time. Take the case of the export of PPE kits and N95 masks, which India prohibited by 31st January, 40 days before the World Health Organization declared COVID-19 a pandemic. From 19th of March, the export of surgical masks and ventilators were also prohibited. Still many people are blindly criticizing the government. I don't know why. My opposition strongly believes that lockdown was imposed in a very unstrategized manner. But I would like to ask them that what is a strategized manner for approximately 130 crore population? I believe that they would be speechless, because it's very easy to blame one, but it's equally difficult to put that blame on ourselves. Studies indicate that about 93% people were in favor of the lockdown at the beginning, because the situation was so quick that people unfortunately got very less time to criticize the government. But now, as time is passing on, opposition is trying its level best to create hurdles for the central government. Is the opposition having tomatoes in their eyes, so that is why they are unable to see the current situation? The Arogya Setu app was also introduced by the central government for the protection of the people. But when I ask people that, have you downloaded this app, then they simply say that it's of no use, let's just not waste our time. Some people shockingly also say that, oh, it fills up my phone space, so it's rather better not to download it. It's because of this attitude you are criticizing the central government? If yes, then you need to think twice, people. You need to think twice. WHO is too claiming that India has a tremendous capacity to deal with the coronavirus because it has the experience of eradicating smallpox and particularly polio. And now please just don't say that Narendra Modi and WHO too are having a collusion. The government too has announced a massive special economic package of 20 lakh crore to revive the economy of the country. Earlier, India did not manufacture PPE or N95 masks. But today, India is manufacturing more than 2 lakh each of PPE and N95 masks daily. Therefore, the government is trying its level best to deal with the crisis. At last, I would like to conclude by saying, our minds are lost in a world of crisis. Lives are turning breathless. Writing on our luck with the back of a pen would not take us to our longing desire. So let's just join our hands and acquire, and acquire, and acquire. Thank you.
Well, I must say, Saloni, you have set the bar high and the enthusiasm level is on another level. Well, if you can't convince them, then you may confuse them. That's what most of the interjectors usually do. So here I call upon our next interjector up in the fray. Over to you, interjectors.
Yes, so Saloni, I am like quite impressed by your speech. But then also one question arises in my mind that like we have heard many cases of patients having cancer or many other life-threatening diseases, like their immunity is going very low and causing to their death. So, and this is all because of like the environment in the hospitals. So what arrangements have been made to ensure that the patients having cancer and many life-threatening diseases, they have proper support and proper treatment going on?
Well, Winston Churchill has correctly stated that an optimistic is the one who finds opportunity in every difficulty, but a pessimistic is one who finds difficulty in every of the opportunity. So I believe that we must be optimistic, just like our Prime Minister Narendra Modi. And just like I stated in my speech, ventilators have been made earlier at the time of swine flu also. N95 mask and PPE kits were not manufactured in India. It was imported. But now, seeing the situation, we are just, the government is just trying to cope up with the situation at the best it could. And speaking of the lockdown was also imposed for this only. And the first two phases of lockdown itself avoided 78,000 deaths and about 29 lakh cases. So government is trying its level best. That's all. Thank you.
Well, Saloni, you have indeed set the bar very high. But now let's call upon Rudransh Nareda to express his views against the motion.
Okay, so let me start. Mostly beloved Narendra Modi, who came up with some innovative and effective ideas at the onset of corona crisis, like banning thalis and talis, is missing when COVID-19 cases are escalating rapidly. I wish if the same person who was busy dividing the country in early 2020 would have paid some attention to the upcoming corona pandemic, and instead of building party offices worth 700 crores and statues worth 3000 crores, were more concerned in building hospitals, then perhaps the condition of the country would have been a little more stable. I agree the COVID-19 pandemic was highly unanticipated, but we cannot shut our eyes on how the government did not ban the entry of Asian and European citizens till the 3rd of March, even after knowing that these areas were already affected by coronavirus. And it took another 19 full days to suspend all international travel, 11 days after the announcement of COVID-19 as a global pandemic. Between January 18th and March 23rd, 1.5 million people already entered India without any tests and precautions except thermal screening. All this led to coronavirus sowing its seeds in India. The second huge mistake made by the Indian government was how unwisely India was exporting PPE kits, masks and other safety logistics even in this difficult time. Nor did they issue any specifications on the design, quality and testing of COVID-19 safety gear for manufacturers to start production. According to Invest India Agency, 38 million masks and 7 million coveralls were required in India, while only 10 million masks and 8 lakh coveralls were available, which led to near about thousands of doctors, nurses and paramedics affected by coronavirus by May 2020. Another big issue was the shortage of mechanical ventilators, our only strong weapon against a respiratory syndrome like COVID-19. Paradoxically, India is an exporter of ventilators. And again, it was only on March 19th that the center stopped ventilator exports. And now, what is government doing? Photoshopping the ventilators and editing them with PM Care stickers. And it shivers my spine every time when I recall how millions of migrant laborers had to walk to their addresses in this struggling time, only because of the unplanned and impromptu lockdown by the Indian government. At first, they established the lockdown without any information and kept extending it, which broke the laborers' patience and they started heading towards their homes. And the government who can spend crores on advertising on helicopters, didn't even care to arrange some vehicles for them, which led to hundreds of laborers being killed on the roads and tracks. And then, after 2 months, when the government again unexpectedly ended the lockdown, and when factories and industries needed human force to rebuild the economy, laborers were already at their places. And at last, I'll end by saying that now, coronavirus cases are increasing at a devastating rate and are already above 4 lakh. The government has lightened their shoulders and has bestowed the responsibility of handling coronavirus to 50 state governments and are themselves busy campaigning for coming elections. Thank you.
Well, Rudransh, I must say, you are giving quite the competition. But now, to test your abilities, I request Vinayak to put forward his questions.
I respect your views, but at the time when China wasn't revealing anything and we didn't know that coronavirus would become such a global pandemic, and when the information leaked, Indian government started and did what the best it could do. I know that the health infrastructure should have been developed since long ago, but if we have got an opportunity to realize that now we have to develop at a more fast rate, the government is doing a splendid job, because to lead one of the most populous and most diversified country isn't easy, and the government is also battling out the locust attacks, the earthquakes, Indo-China border tensions, and there are various things, but still the government is united and people believe in PM and the government. So don't you think that it is our responsibility to not to go out of our homes, because we are the people who are being cared of by them and we are the ones who are disobeying the guidelines?
Yes, we should not go out of our homes. I didn't stated anything related to this. we should not go out of our homes. That's all. Okay.
Hello. Actually, I'm
sorry, Vinayak, but counter questioning is not allowed. You may do it in the comment section.
Easiest question I ever heard.
Okay. Moving forward, now I would like to invite Akshit Vashish to put forward his outlook in favor of the motion. Over to you, Akshit.
Namaskar. In the era of global pandemic, where government in many countries decoupled to contain this contagious virus, or we can say COVID-19, this virus has broken the many emerging economies and many developed economies. And now the question arises here that where India is standing, on which carpet. So, as being a Vishwa Guru and having the title of Vishwa Guru, India is a helping hand over the worldwide. We provided PPE kits and hydroxychloroquine to the nations which are having the title of superpower, to the nation which one separated us with the policy of divide and rule. We do not discriminate any nation as our enemy or as a friend. Indian government was very vigilant, specific and decisive in every decision. Indian government encouraged every state government to and ask their opinions and views about their views about this pandemic. And this made the decision very accurate and proactive with the time. As understanding the hour of the need, Indian government also looked further for the migrants. Now the topic of the migrant is a topic which helped many journalists and many Indian media to gain TRPs. It's kind of that topic. So to control that migrant crisis, the special Shramik trains were on the track and migrant employees were sent back to their families. And BPL families and the migrants were given food grains at the low cost. By giving end, 50,000 crore was spent to send these migrants. 50,000 crores were spent to send these migrants back to their home by giving chance to develop their village by their talents, which were never recognized in the city. Now, looking at the 360, Indian industries need the help. So to help these small-scale industries and these industries, the government gave 10% of the GDP. I'm repeating, 10% of the GDP, which is 80 lakh crores, to help these industries. Now, I want to ask my opposition, then how then they critic a government which had done so much in such a short period of time. And in spite of throwing money in just digging the pit all over the India, our opposition would have done the work for the nation, for the welfare of the nation. Thank you.
Very well done, Akshit. Now I would like to invite Anushka Sharma to give Akshit a mind puzzle.
Akshit, the economic packages that were announced by the government were very delayed. Also, they included many of the schemes which were already announced at the time of annual budget, and they were not the part of corona crisis management. Is this not misleading the citizens of the country? Also, may I know for the answer for this question, that at various places, including Punjab, Maharashtra and Bihar, police department and administrative personnels have manhandled the people and also violated their human rights. Was better management not expected from them? Is this an effective handling of a crisis?
What police and administration did, according to me, was very effective. If someone is not doing what he is supposed to do in this time of crisis, then they are punishable, according to me. And I don't think any kind of their rights were violated, because if their rights were not violated at that time, they would have infected many of the persons in which they were contacting. So according to me, it was correct.
That was an amazing question, Anushka. And that was a really good answer, Akshay. So now I would like to call our last participant, Jia Juneja, to balance out the debate and put forward her views against the motion.
Success is not final. Failure is not fatal. It is the courage to continue that counts. Currently, the whole world is suffering from a pandemic, and we all hope that we'll get through this. But we should know that if Modi government handled this efficiently or not. At the time of crisis, there are two kinds of speeches. One, which raises the morale of the population, much like Winston Churchill wartime speeches. And the other, which gives direction to the troops so that they can know what exactly to do. The problem with the novel coronavirus or COVID-19 is that it requires the populaces to be soldiers, every single one of us. So we needed both morale boosters and specifics. And this is where our Prime Minister Narendra Modi failed monumentally. His earlier speech for a day of solidarity or Janta Garfi was about morale. But his speech announcing the 21-day pan-nationwide lockdown was in effect a military campaign. In fact, all his speeches relating to this reveal that he's just like Nehru, can win elections and nothing else. We are now at this stage that we need fast testing, cheap testing, easily available testing, and a well-laid-down mechanism to quarantine a person the moment he or she is found positive, without letting them infect others, including the medical staff and the family members. The lack of widespread testing, as well as the lack of PPEs or personal protective equipment for the doctors, is a scandal. I personally believe that when there was just one case of COVID-19 found in India, there should have been a complete curfew for 10 to 15 days so that no one could go out, and that one person should have been given proper medication and treatment so that he would have recovered well. Because we already knew the situation of China in January, and we had to be more aware. And at that time, international flights should have been suspended for a month or so, because most of the virus entered India because of tourists and other people from foreign countries entering our country. PM Narendra Modi said, timing is very important, on his meeting with the chief ministers, although he was late enough to take an action against this pandemic. India is a very populated country, and 135 crore population can't manage to stay indoors for a span of 2 to 3 months, leaving all their work, as this pandemic has most of all dipped the economy of a country. The poor do not have food to eat, businesses are not working, and the job-based people are not getting their salaries. One has to be really naive to believe India's official numbers of coronavirus patients. Sadly, the evidence so far suggests that Modi government does not have the capacity to think through the details of planning and execution. Thank you.
That was a terrific performance, Jia. Now, I would like to call upon Pakhi to ask questions related to your speech.
So yes, Jia, actually, officials have said that in India, the rate at which the COVID cases are doubling, it's less than other countries, right? And in India, furthermore, the death rates are low and the testing rates are much higher. Okay, so why do you think that the Modi government was not successful in managing this situation?
Actually, I believe that we have a large population. So this much population can't manage to leave all their work for 2 to 3 months, because it was good. From the starting of 21 days of lockdown, but then it kept extending, and now also the rates are increasing day by day. So I agree that death rates are low, but and recovery rates are also high, but the testing, it's very costly in India, and also we have a large population on the comparison of other countries as well.
That was an amazing answer, Jia. Well, I must say,
this was
an enthralling session. Now, I would like to invite Srimati Vanita Raj Purohit ma'am to express her views on the competition.
So, respected members of SNC, although they are not here now, founder principal ma'am, principal sir, my dear colleagues and students, it's an honor and pleasure to be here as a part of this event today. My compliments to all participants for their valuable efforts and enthusiasm. Participation and zeal to excel are the keynotes to success. Keep the good work going. The topic was indeed debatable and very much relevant. It's a contemporary situation. Opinions are personal, and my views are partially in support of both for and against. As unprecedented as the crisis itself, the pandemic, also are the efforts of the central government and the state governments. People never knew that this kind of a situation would arise anytime. Nobody even dreamt of it, such a disaster. There are states who have managed it very well. Kerala has become a role model for the entire country because of widespread education. And for our information, the health minister of Kerala has been taken recognized by UN itself. So we have examples to set. As citizens, we have our own responsibilities. We owe our thanks to the government and to the brave warriors who are fighting to save lives. But there have been areas which could have been better managed with much transparency. But as I said, opinions are personal. So at the same time, we can contribute our bit in improving the situation, in controlling the situation by not getting panic, by following the protocol, and by following the new normal. Thank you, and keep the good work going in future as well. Hope the planet recovers soon. Stay safe, stay protected.
Thank you, ma'am. Now I would like to invite Srimati Poornima Vaidya ma'am to share her views regarding today's debate.
Namaskar, sir, principal, and ma'am, and my dear students. I must first of all congratulate all the participants for their wonderful performances. You all deserve accolades for the kind of confidence and conviction with which you expressed, articulated, and analyzed the measures taken by Government of India to hold and constrain this pandemic COVID-19. Keeping in view the transmission mode of this devastating disease and the social, cultural, and geographical, you know, considerations of our country and the learning, on the basis of the learning experiences from global, you know, countries, our government has definitely taken strong and prompt actions to contain this pandemic, this devastating pandemic, right? And I think social distancing is the only social, you know, vaccine against this disease, because right now we do not have any medical, you know, vaccine against it. But this is possible only government measures, you know, are successful only when the citizens have the will to support the government. And we as citizens have the responsibility to do that. And you being the young sentinels of a country have the responsibility to generate and create that awareness. Very well done, everyone. And please keep safe. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Now I would request our honorable guest, Mr. Shubham Maheshwari, to share his experience of the competition.
Am I audible?
Yeah.
Okay. Am I audible, guys? So congratulations, guys. I think
all the
participants, congratulations, you've spoken really well. I understand the challenges when we specially deal with online competitions, whether it's online debate competition or any other such competition, because we don't have the physical presence, we cannot feel the energy as such. But I must congratulate all the participants. You have really shown great enthusiasm in not only delivering your points, but also questioning each other and making taking out notes from the other speeches and then rebutting it in your speeches. So for that, all of you deserve a great round of applause and congratulations. Moving forward, I think I should make a statement as to whether I support this motion or not, or whether I'm in favor of the motion or against the motion. But however, there was one reference that came of Winston Churchill. Two of the speakers made the reference of Winston Churchill. And very surprisingly, one was made by Saloni and one was made by Gia, right? one was for the favor of the motion and Jia was speaking in against the motion. So see, the great leaders can always be holded against, for and against. They have their statements have such power that it can be used by either side. So whenever you use such statements, make sure that you're using it correctly. And the reference drawn from those statements should be, you know, pointed out and should be conveyed very effectively. One thing I had to say. Also, I really think that the Narendra Modi government did not manage this crisis efficiently. This is my personal opinion. I have been a staunch critique of this government and the previous Modi government as well. However, my point being that the Modi government had the case in the last week of January, like the country witnessed its last first case in the last week of January, and we had the appropriate time and opportunity to enforce the lockdowns, but still we waited till March 3rd week. A, probably for the reason budget session was in progress in Parliament, MP government had to be destabilized by the current ruling government of centre, that is BJP. Till 21st of March, Parliament was working. The second session of budget session was being taken in place. MP government was being dethroned. Airport authority rules and port authority rules were not enforced of quarantine. International flights were still operating. No information were given to labourers. Suddenly, the trains and everything was locked down after Janta curfew was was implemented. So there are a lot of problems when it comes to dealing with the crisis efficiently. I'm saying that Congress or any other political party is a saint like that, and they would have done it efficiently. However, the fact is the government could have done a little better when it comes to the fact that they could have accepted the buses provided by Priyanka Gandhi rather than hassling on the problem of whether there are papers available or not for the buses, as if we always see the papers of our political leaders who get elected into the parliament or legislative assemblies. Any which ways, a lot of problems were created rather than finding solutions. However, I must congratulate, and I think we all owe it to the warriors, the doctors and the medical staff who have been working day in and night and working tirelessly to make sure that everybody gets treated. However, the government was still not content with their duty, and All India Medical Science Delhi, AIIMS Delhi's doctors union was asked for a salary cut in March or in April, and give that salary cut as a donation to PM CARES fund, which was refused, obviously, because obviously rather than doing a salary cut, the government should be giving them more of incentives and salaries. But nonetheless, one thing that this government, or probably I should say the Prime Minister, is seriously capable of is molding the opinion. So earlier we were happy banging our thalis, lighting our diyas, and now we are happy dealing with the corona crisis key. And we say that, okay, whatever, we should learn to live with it rather than to criticize the government. So I think all the young minds here, you all are very young, and I think it's the right time for you to start questioning. There's a difference between dissent and there's a difference between treason. So you need to understand that when you're questioning your government, you're not into treason. You are actually exercising your democratic right, and you have all the right to do so because your constitution guarantees it so. Because the government is busy denying bail to Safura Zarghar, who just got bail recently. Food security bill is not being implemented properly. Rajasthan High Court has issued notices day before yesterday. Seeking a reply from the government as to why food is not being provided. And there are a lot of examples that I have written down, but I think you will get a little bored because I'll start comparing to Caligula of Rome, Mr. Modi to Caligula of Rome, and I don't think that would be a right thing to do. So let's move forward, and I think all of you have done a commendable job. Make sure that you keep on doing such things, and make sure that you keep on questioning whatever you believe, because unless and until you don't do that, you're not evolving and growing. And the entire point of these debate competitions and interjectors being kept and everything is to make sure that you find a better reasoning and you evolve as a person, not only in your personality but also in your thoughts, because that is what the idea behind this debate competition was. So congratulations, guys. Thank you so much. You all have done really well. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I would request Principal, sir, to share with us a few words of encouragement.
Namaskar everyone, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
First of all, I believe both the judges as well as our honorable guest Shubham also has mentioned that the what is the debate competition all about? It is not about fighting with each other. It is about learning. It is about reasoning. It is about finding the facts and then analyzing the situation and then putting it in the correct perspective. So very rightly being put up by Shubham over here, and I thank him for whatever I had to say. He has already mentioned it, so I don't have many more words to add on to what he has mentioned. I would only add, yes, compliment goes to the organizers, the comparers, the speakers, whether you are in favor of the motion or whether you are in against the motion. Only important thing is that you collect your facts, analyze them, present them, and leave it for the judges to decide how other aspects have been dealt with. Well, opinions can be various. And we have our own opinions whenever we talk about any situation. Some would go in favor and some would go in against. And no person can be absolutely neutral in any kind of a situation. So I had listed down few points, which few of them have already been mentioned by many of the speakers and then later on by Shubham as well. Like the migrant situation which has been talked about, it is still debatable whether it was right for the government to move them from the location they were in. And because, why I'm saying so, because now the laborers or migrants have been moved to a particular situation where their hometown was or home was. Now because of the unemployment, they are willing to come back to the place where they were already staying in. So was this decision correct at that moment of time? If at all it was right, and as we understand, since I belong to Delhi and I'm right now also in Delhi where the situation is worsening day by day, I get to hear the chief minister saying over here that we had enough funds and enough money available, enough food available to ensure that migrants and everyone is taken care of. If it was such a situation, why at all migrants were willing to leave? That is a big question to be asked. And obviously the availability of PPE kits, medical staff, all that remains a pertinent question. Very rightly being put up, January was the day or date or month, I should call, when we were aware that the first case of coronavirus has been spotted in India, and we were aware how it has spread in China, which is our neighboring country only. We should have taken that decision there and then that we are calling off all the international flights, specifically at least from the country which are right now affected or are being affected at the moment of time, and should have increased the testing of those people who had come in last 15-20 days to curb the situation we are in right now. And as the new mantra now is being said is that we have to live with it. We have no choice actually, but to live with it. But at the same time, it is also our duty that being citizens of this country, we abide by the instructions which are given in our favor. Economy also has to function, and government cannot provide us food unless they also make money. And in order to make money, they will have to open up the economy. And in order to open up the economy, they are issuing certain guidelines to ensure that social distancing is maintained, wearing of mask is important. And as far as possible, let us not step out of our homes unless it becomes absolutely necessary. So if we all are going to abide by these instructions, we are sure that yesterday we all are aware that our Baba Ramdev ji has claimed that he has got a cure for it. Whether it is true or not, it is yet to be testified. But one thing is very sure, that a person cannot claim on a national platform that he has found a cure and he is just making fun of everyone. There has to be some substance in what he is saying. It is only a matter of time that it has to be tested. And I keep my fingers crossed that in case it is a cure, then we are in a happy situation and the world is going to be cured very soon. Apart from all the other research which is going on across the globe, where many candidates for the vaccines have reached the final stages, the day is not very far away. And let me use, though I would not like to use this word, even the astrologers are saying that by September you are going to get some kind of respite from the disease which we are going through right now, and the conditions will be better by the end of year. So well done all the participants. The lockdown hasn't ended, unlock has started. So whatever instructions are given, whatever guidelines are being issued by different governments, we as citizens should abide by them. And once again, my compliments to all the speakers. Winning and losing will continue. It was a digital platform and a different kind of a ball game. I am sure judges would have found it very difficult to jot down their points and the energy level which is otherwise seen right when they are observing the participant and the speaker in their presence, in their when the speaker is speaking in their front, and the energy level which is being generated from the audience level also. And that was obviously not seen over here, though through the comment boxes we could see it. So let's see that how Unlock 1, which is now Unlock 2, which has now started, goes on, and soon we will be in a situation where we'll be able to open the schools and we'll be able to see each other physically, and we may have another round of debate on the same situation. So thank you very much for inviting me for such an encouraging and engraving session. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir.
So let's please go on.
Thank you, everyone. Hopefully the audience has enjoyed the debate. And now I'll be presenting the vote of thanks to Captain B.C. Kumar Vitta, Priyadarshi Kachwaha, our respected principal, sir, for sparing their time and dedicating their time in this event and making it more graceful. Also, I would like to extend our thanks to our guest, Mr. Shubham Maheshwari, who helped the participants, the interjectors, and us as well throughout the competition. I also extend my heartfelt thanks to our teacher in charges, Dr. Bharati Sharma ma'am, Dr. Shweta Saxena ma'am, Dr. Sarvesh Parekh sir, and all the participants, all the interjectors, and the Chirayu Chaudhary behind the time buzzer, and you all have made the event so smooth, and hopefully everyone enjoyed it. Stay safe, stay home. Thank you.